Shankar from Chemical Engineering IIT Kanpur. In a series of three lectures, I plan to provide you a rather bird's eye view of this subject of hydrodynamic stability. Coming to the theme of this pedagogical workshop, which is complex fluids and geophysical flows, and the following symposium that is going to ensue after 2 weeks, that is on complex fluids and interfaces. I would like to convince you that this forms an important toolkit to understand various physical phenomena in all these subfields of mechanics. So, in that sense, it's a very powerful set of tools that one uses to understand how various systems become unstable, especially fluid dynamical systems. Okay, I'm going to use little bit of slides and little bit of board work as well. So, the first part of the talk will be mostly slides, and then I'll switch to the board. So, the outline for the next three lectures roughly is as follows. I'll try to introduce and motivate the subject of hydrodynamic stability, and then from there I will try to tell you how one analyzes the stability of flows to infinitesimal or unavoidable disturbances, which is called the linear stability theory. And then I will set up a simple trivial toy example to illustrate the steps that are involved and how one analyzes the results. Then I will go to more realistic instabilities and classical instabilities such as Rayleigh-Taylor, Kelvin-Helmholtz, Rayleigh-Plateau instabilities. And then at the end of the three lectures, I hope to indicate what are the issues involved in understanding stability of parallel shear flows, like flow in a tube or flow in a channel or boundary layer flows. So, these are harder problems, whereas these classical problems are very relatively successful in terms of the treatment, in terms of predictions of experimental observations. So, this is the rough outline. So, some of the references for people who are not familiar with the subject are the following. Drazin's little book on hydrodynamic stability is very useful for a beginner, and same with Sharu's book on hydrodynamic instabilities. For somewhat more advanced learners, you should look at Drazin and Reed's classic on hydrodynamic stability, which is a more detailed version of the little book by Drazin. And the book by Schmid and Henningsen focuses on subclass of problems involving parallel shear flows mostly, and especially involving what is called transient growth. I will try to explain what that is briefly as we go along. And for people who are interested in thermal convection and hydromagnetic systems, Chandrasekhar's classic is a very useful reference. It has a compendium of results on that subject. And of course, nothing is like viewing experiments and experimental observations. There is a very classic old fluid mechanical video called Instability and Transition from the Shapiro videos of MIT, and it's available very easily in YouTube, so you can go take a look. That's also extremely informative and and it gives you deep insights into how these things pan out in experiments and in natural phenomena. Okay, so that is in terms of the overall references that that this subject that gives a good overview of the subject. So let's go to introduce the subject and motivate you to this class of problems that we are interested in. So when you open a tap or a faucet, right, and when you open it a little bit, you see that the water stream comes out very gently from the faucet. And but then if you open the faucet or tap a little bit more, then you see a very, very complicated flow that comes out of this the same system. Okay, so you can clearly see that depending on a parameter like how much you turn the valve or flow rate of the fluid, then you see very, very different flow behavior in this very simple domestic kind of a setting. Another example is smoke from a cigarette or an incense stick. If you don't want to smoke. So, here is a photograph from that Shapiro video again. So, here you have the smoke particles acting as flow markers actually. So, initially this is just hot fluid rising above. So, it rises above in a very nice manner, and then it becomes more complicated and chaotic. This is an example again of an instability. So these are more uncontrolled experiments. But then if you look at the more controlled system, namely what is called the Taylor-Couette flow, here what you have is you have a inner cylinder and an outer cylinder, and there is fluid or liquid in between the two cylinders, in the annular gap between the two cylinders, and you start rotating the inner cylinder. Now at relatively small Reynolds numbers, or Taylor number as it is called in this subfield of fluid mechanics, right? So what happens is you get a purely azimuthal flow. So if you look at a cylindrical coordinate system where z is aligned along the axis of the cylinder, r is into the radial direction and theta goes in this direction, you will purely see v theta velocity component, and fluid is going round and round. And this is something that we normally do as an assignment problem in an undergraduate course in fluid mechanics. What is the velocity profile and what is the torque required to move the inner cylinder and so on. So this is a very, very simple flow kinematics. Now what J. Taylor found as he increased the inner angular velocity of the inner cylinder is that this flow pattern is not always observed. So this flow pattern becomes unstable. I'll make this phrase unstable more quantitative as we go along. And then you don't see this happening in experiments as you increase the angular velocity of the inner cylinder or a non-dimensional parameter like the Reynolds or Taylor number. So then you see, you don't see a pure azimuthal flow, you also see a flow in the axial direction. Okay. What are called Taylor cells which are going round and round like this, and then there is also that is superimposed on a flow that is also going like this. So these are the cells that you see, the bands that you see are actually what are called Taylor vortices which go like this. And then as you keep increasing the inner angular velocity of the inner cylinder, what you find is that the flow becomes more complicated, and then you get what are called wavy vortices. Now the flow becomes also non-axisymmetric, there is variation in the theta direction as well, and then eventually you get a very complicated random turbulent flow. So this is one of the most famous illustrations of a sequence of instabilities that happen in a rather simple geometry. This is called the Taylor-Couette cell or Taylor-Couette flow. Now the other classic example is that of Rayleigh-Bennard convection, which was explained by, yes.
So in the last series, if I have a fluid particle, it's basically moving in a helix, isn't
it? Yes, yes.
So I'm assuming that earlier it was just doing this.
Right.
It started doing this. And in the last one, it does something more than that?
Here it's turbulent. It's not. It's turbulent, so it will be much more complicated. So here the flow is rather. It's simple, yet it's two dimensional. But it's not the unidirectional flow. But you know, I'm not looking at a single particle and following it in a Lagrangian way. Even if you look at the Eulerian flow field, it will be rather simple. You have this VR flow, and then by conservation of mass. Much like Rayleigh-Bennard convection, it hits the outer wall, and then it comes like this, right? Due to centrifugal effects. I'll come to that a little later. So this is the class, and in the turbulent regime, it's much more complicated. So if you look at a single point velocity field, if you look at its variation with time, it's quite random. Whereas here, it's predictable, right? I mean, at best, it will be time periodic. So the final example is one which was explained by Professor Huppert yesterday. So this is the famous Rayleigh-Bennard convection, where you have a thin layer of sufficiently thick layer of liquid, and then because if you have sufficiently thin liquids, you get different instability due to Marangoni effects. So if you have a thick layer of liquid and then you start heating it from below, and because the lower part of the fluid is now hotter, it's less dense than the upper part of fluid, so it's potentially unstable, but it doesn't immediately become unstable because you still find that the pure conduction static to be observed in experiments because of the dissipative effects of both viscosity as well as thermal diffusion. So you need a critical temperature gradient for the flow to become unstable, and once it becomes unstable, you get a kind of pattern that you see if you do it in a circular dish. It will look like this. If you do it in a different geometry, the patterns will look different, but the physics of the instability is rather identical, but you know, the details of the geometry imposes different patterns as depending on the boundary conditions. So this is what is, this is called the Rayleigh-Bennard convection or the thermal convection problem. So these are some of the most commonly seen instabilities in real life as well as in rather ideal control systems, and these are well studied. Now a bit of history on this subject. The after Navier and Stokes found these equations called the Navier-Stokes equations, then there were a lot of studies on what is the flow rate of fluid in a pipe done by Hagen and Poiseuille, right? And then there was a lot of interest, but one of the first important studies in the study in the history of hydrodynamic stability is the work by Osborne Reynolds, which I'll explain in a bit. So this is a famous laminar turbulent transition in a pipe flow. This was done in mid 1880s. Okay. So basically what I'm trying to say is the pioneers are applied mathematicians and mathematical physicists in England and Europe in late 1800s and early 1900s. The first experiment being the one by Reynolds. In fact, this paper of Reynolds came up with this non-dimensional combination which we now call the Reynolds number. He used it as the single dimensionless group that marks the transition from laminar to what we call turbulent flow. Now there are other important players, von Helmholtz, Lord Kelvin, Lord Rayleigh, Niels Bohr, Arnold Sommerfeld, Werner Heisenberg. In fact, interestingly, Heisenberg's PhD thesis was on hydrodynamic stability in 1923. He wanted to understand the pipe flow transition. I would like to tell you that if he had started doing that problem, he would still be doing his PhD and he would not have finished it. Because the problem is still not solved. So, but Heisenberg being very clever, he switched to quantum mechanics, right? So, so, and of course, you have the Indian-American physicist Chandrasekhar, who did a lot of work on hydromagnetic stability and hydro and convection and rotating flows and stuff like that. And the Russian mathematician Arnold did a lot of work on understanding it from a dynamical systems perspective. So, you will see that the initial parts of this subject was developed largely by mathematical physicists of those times, and then of course engineers were naturally interested because this problem of course has important implications on several engineering applications. Also I would like to point out that there is a mathematical institute in the US called the Clay Mathematics Institute, and they posed in the beginning of this century or millennium seven very very important problems in mathematics, and if you make a big headway into solving that problem, then you would be given a large number of money for making a successful attempt at it, right? Now one of the seven problems which they put up in their website is related to what is called the the Navier-Stokes equation. So I'm not able to read it from here, so I'll go a little bit. So I think it's pretty bad anyway, so I'm not going to make an effort. So I'll just paraphrase what they said. So what they're saying is that in order to unlock the secrets behind the solution of mathematical solution of Navier-Stokes equations, because most of it is not known, and is there any general way of looking at solutions of Navier-Stokes equations? So this is by and large what they put up in their website as one of the problems to be solved in order to get a huge prize. So, and I would like to tell you that the subject area of hydrodynamic stability, at least insofar as Newtonian fluids are concerned, is closely related to this question of what are the solutions of Navier-Stokes equations and so on. So it's a very very topical and important subject, albeit being much more very very old in the sense of being 140, 150 years old. Okay, so let's go back to the famous Reynolds experiments. Most of us study, get to know about this in our first fluid mechanics courses in our undergraduate education. So what Reynolds did, this is a cartoon that appeared in one of the review articles in Annual Reviews of Fluid Mechanics. So this apparently is not Reynolds, but it's his assistant. So this was the title of the paper, and in those days the titles were pretty much very very long. An experimental investigation of the circumstances which determine whether the motion of water shall be direct, which is what we call laminar nowadays, or sinuous, which is what we refer to as turbulent. Okay, these were the terms used by Reynolds for his title. Now what he did is very simple. He did it in Manchester. If I understand correctly, the setup is still preserved in Manchester, and you can go and take a look at the original setup, the glass tube. He took a glass tube and then he flew water in it, and then he used a thin colored dye, much similar to Professor Huppert's dye experiment yesterday. He just took a simple colored dye, passed it, And then at small flow rates, he was, and this shape of the entry of the pipe is to ensure that there are no disturbances as the fluid is getting into the pipe. You are trying to avoid inlet disturbances by having some kind of a entry like this, right? And when the flow rates are small, the dye streak appears very, very straight. This is what we call laminar flow, right? And in this flow regime, the velocity profile, the mathematical form of the velocity profile will be the famous Hagen-Poiseuille velocity profile that we all work out in our undergraduate courses. But when Reynolds increased the flow rate of water, then he found that at some point, then this dye streak doesn't remain straight, it becomes a little bit more chaotic, and then again it becomes straight, and then it becomes a little bit more chaotic, and so on. So there is this region called for some range of flow rates where there is a sort of you know, there is a patch of fluid which is turbulent, again it is laminar, again it becomes turbulent, and so on. Eventually at beyond a critical Reynolds number, which we as we now refer to, beyond a critical flow rate, then he finds that the dye gets completely mixed up due to the complicated turbulent motion. The key thing to realize is that the flow field is completely unidirectional here and it is time independent, okay, and the pressure drop is acting in this direction. Here also the pressure drop is acting in this direction along the axial direction of the pipe, yet the flow field is three dimensional. Even though the drive is in one direction, the result, even though the cause is in one direction, the result is three dimensional, and even though the cause is time independent, the result is time dependent. The flow field is random in terms of both its variation in space and time. So this complicated motion is what we call turbulent flow. And what Reynolds did is not just to observe this, he also found very importantly, as I just said, that there is a single dimensionless number which we now call as Reynolds number in honor of this identification, which marks this transition. So it does not matter which fluid you use, which tube diameter you use, as long as the fluid is Newtonian, it will always be this particular number, which is around 2000 to 2200. Okay. There are more details to this transition and I will tell you a little bit later. This is just by way of motivation. Even experimentally there are more layers to this this story. Okay. Now this transition which we just saw from Reynolds's experiments also has more practical implication. This is the classic friction factor charts that we use in engineering fluid mechanics, where you in the y axis you have a friction factor which is a non-dimensional pressure drop, and in the x axis you have a Reynolds number which is like a non-dimensional average velocity of the flow, right. So when you use the Hagen-Poiseuille velocity profile, which is an analytical solution to the Navier-Stokes equation, you will find that the friction factor goes as 1 over Reynolds. It is a double logarithmic plot. So this is a line with slope minus 1, but around this point, this is corresponding to the onset of transition. If the flow were to be laminar, this line should continue all the way with the same slope, but experimentally you do not find this, the experimental data jumps here and then it starts following here. So this has macroscopic consequences in the sense that if you want to drive the flow at a given Reynolds in the turbulent regime, you need much larger pressure drop, okay, compared to if the flow were to be laminar, because then this line would extend, it leads to much lower pressure drops. So this has practical consequences. Suppose you are trying to pump petrol or crude oil or whatever, and then of course there is lots of energy costs if you do it in the turbulent regime compared to what would happen if you were to do it in the laminar regime. On the other hand, turbulent flows have their own advantages in the sense that they are very good in mixing stuff, like the illustration Professor Huppert showed yesterday, okay. So if you have more complex flows, mixing is rather quick, because the length scales for mixing is drastically reduced by the turbulent eddies when compared to the pure molecular diffusion, where you just rely on viscosity or other diffusive processes to even out gradients, okay. So this is a macroscopic consequence that we are all familiar with from our engineering education, but it has its underpinnings in the laminar turbulent transition which Reynolds first studied, okay. So one thing that I would like to point out is that the number 2000 to 2200 is not very sacrosanct, that is only for tubes. If you look at sufficiently wide rectangular channels, by which I mean the width of the channel is large compared to its the thickness in which fluid is flowing, then the transition happens at a Reynolds of about 1200, which is, you know, so the number is not so important. The number, whether it is 2000 or 1200, so that differs from geometry to geometry. You can imagine if I change the aspect ratio of the channel, of course, the experimental Reynolds number at which the onset happens will be different, right? So that is not very important. The key thing is that there is a transition. Okay, now it is believed that at least insofar as Newtonian fluids are concerned, the Navier-Stokes equations are supposed to contain all the information in terms of understanding the flow behavior, unless you go to very, very tiny, you know, geometries like nano dimensions where, you know, additional surface effects can become potentially important. But if you look at macro scale flows, it's believed that Navier-Stokes equation have all the information. So, but yet the laminar flows that we often study in our, you know, at least when we learn fluid mechanics, is that they are only a very, very special class of solutions to the Navier-Stokes equations. Because, you know, you make several assumptions on the kinematics of the flow to make the Navier-Stokes equations tractable, and therefore they are a very, very special set of solutions to the Navier-Stokes equations. Okay. But, and some of the classic examples are the plane couette flow, plane Poisson flow, pi Poisson flow that we often study, and but that flow is not observed in nature. When, you know, that flow is observed in reality only when the Reynolds number is below 2000 in a pipe, and above that you don't see that laminar solution that you derive. Okay, so and once the flow becomes unstable after a sequence of events, it becomes turbulent eventually, and as I just pointed out, turbulent flows have their own advantages. In terms of mixing, improved mixing, but then they also have very high drag. But on the other hand, laminose flows have low drag, but they also have very poor mixing. So the subject of hydrodynamic stability, one of the major motivations is to understand when does a given laminar flow becomes unstable. And typically the question that we would like to address is, what is the number at which this phenomenon happens, this transition happens. Okay, this is the standard Navier-Stokes equation for incompressible flows. This is the continuity or mass conservation equation. This is the momentum equation, right? So the left side is the acceleration term, and the I have not included gravity explicitly. You can think of that being absorbed in the pressure itself, the pressure gradient itself. The right side are the various forces. These are the viscous forces, and I have written a non-dimensional version, so you don't see viscosities floating around. And this is the pressure gradient in the fluid. And remember, in incompressible flows, the pressure is mechanical variable, it is not a thermodynamic variable, it is merely set by this constraint that volume is preserved in the flow. Okay, this is not the thermodynamic pressure when the fluid is flowing. Okay, so as I just told, laminar flows are a special class of flows that are exact solutions usually of Navier-Stokes equations, but with very, very simple kinematics, and usually these flows are time independent. The solutions that we derive are time independent. Okay, but Landau and Lifshitz famously said, I'm just quoting them in their book on fluid mechanics, that yet not every solution of the equations of motion, even if it is exact, can actually occur in nature. The flows that occur in nature must not only obey the equations of fluid dynamics, but also they must be stable. Okay, so this is one of the things that, because the fundamental feature of the Navier-Stokes equation, which you should appreciate, is that if you look at the various terms of the Navier-Stokes equation, or let's start with the continuity equation. This is a linear equation. Okay, let's look at term by term. This is the time derivative of the velocity. This is the so-called local acceleration, and that's linear. The pressure drop is linear. The del squared V is linear. But if you look at this term, which is the convected acceleration, this comes because you are trying to follow a particle in order to measure its rate of change of velocity, right? That's a nonlinear term because it's a product of V dotted with grad V. So the Navier-Stokes equations are nonlinear, and nonlinear equations are known to, I mean, you don't have a uniqueness theorem in terms of, if you find a solution for a nonlinear equation, be it algebraic or differential, right, it is not guaranteed that that's the only solution. There can be many solutions. Okay, so it turns out that if you take the Hagen-Poisson flow, for example, in a pipe of a Newtonian fluid, right, it you have a exact solution, and it turns out that that's always valid at any Reynolds number in terms of its mathematical solution. But in reality, that is not observed, because beyond a critical certain Reynolds number, because the equation is nonlinear, it allows for multiple solutions potentially, and the solution that you derived, which is a laminar solution, doesn't become it's no longer stable as you increase a parameter like the Reynolds number. This is one of the underlying features of the Navier-Stokes equation. Now, for example, if you were to think of an equivalent problem in heat conduction, so you have unsteady heat conduction, okay, in a solid. I'm not worrying about conduction heat transfer in a liquid where you have convective effects. If you have heat conduction in a solid, this is the governing heat equation, and it is a very simple equation because it's linear, okay. And once you were able to tell me if you are able to tell me a solution of this equation for a given problem subject to a given initial and boundary conditions, if that solution satisfies this equation, okay, and the initial boundary conditions, then that is the solution because this is a linear equation. So if you had just this type of equation, there would be no chance of things being unstable, okay. There is just one solution and it's always a stable solution, it's always the only solution. Whereas in the case of fluid mechanics, you have this difficult nonlinear term, and that nonlinear term leads to the possibility of multiple solutions at the same time, some being stable and some being unstable. And as you change a parameter, some solutions lose their stability and then some other solutions. This is the simplest possible picture that I can give you in terms of why there is a question of stability and instability, okay, and why you do not have any such problem in heat transfer, in conductive heat transfer, because the system is, the governing equation is linear, okay. So I just told that. So what, in order to understand whether the laminar flows are stable or not as you change a parameter like the Reynolds number, right, so you have to worry about the stability of the flows to external disturbances, because any given flow is always subjected to disturbances of some sort. Be it in the laboratory. Yesterday Professor Huppert showed us an example where he kept a chalk piece, a broken chalk piece, and then he knocked here. Initially the chalk piece was standing vertical, and then he knocked and then it fell down. So that is like a forced disturbance, but in reality there are disturbances that are always there in the entry of the pipe or in the lab due to vibrations in the surrounding environment. In fact, Reynolds, when he did his experiments in 1880s, it's reported that he did experiments both in the day. In those days people used horse carts to travel, right. In the daytime his lab was next to a road where the horses were horse carts were going, and there was a lot of vibration. And then he did the same experiments in the night and he found a different Reynolds number for transition. So it is, disturbances are always there in reality, right. So you have to in order to understand whether the given solution to Navier-Stokes equation is stable or not, from a theoretical point of view, you have to subject it to disturbances, and you need to understand whether those flows remain stable to disturbances or not, okay. This is what I just said. Now what disturbances do is they try to distort the existing force equilibrium. Suppose you had a chalk piece like this, which is like this, and then it's a stable equilibrium, and then I hit this desk very strong and then it's going to fall down. So by introducing a disturbance to a system, to a flow, you are trying to distort, you are in principle distorting the existing force equilibrium. And this is at best illustrated in this classic examples of Rayleigh-Bennard thermal convection and Taylor-Couette flows. In Rayleigh-Bennard convection, what happens is, as Professor Huppert pointed out yesterday, you have a small parcel of hotter fluid and buoyancy is trying to push it up, right, and then that is opposed by thermal diffusion and viscous diffusion of momentum. So that tends to oppose that, and when the temperature difference is not strong enough, then the fluid parcel, although buoyancy is trying to push it up, this doesn't go to form a convection roll like this. But if you have a sufficiently strong enough temperature difference between the two plates, then the dissipative nature of viscosity and conductive thermal diffusion are now overcome by the driving force of buoyancy, and then you start, this fluid parcel starts going up and then hits the top wall and then starts going up and down. That is the convection rule. Now a very identical thing happens in Taylor-Couette geometry, where instead of buoyancy, the centrifugal force plays the role similar to buoyancy. It tends to pull the fluid towards this direction, but initially that is being resisted by viscosity, and then after a critical angle of velocity, the centrifugal forces are strong enough to take the fluid, and then it starts going. This is a vertical cut, so it starts going like this, and you have to revolve it around the axis of the cylinder like that. Okay, so these are the reasons in at least in simpler systems like the Rayleigh-Barnard convection and Taylor Couette flow, the reason why the flow becomes unstable as you change a parameter like the temperature gradient or the angular velocity of the inner flow inner cylinder is quite obvious. Now what happens after the flow becomes unstable? Broadly two scenarios can happen. One is you could have a new complex but still laminar states. For example, I would not call this a turbulent state. This is a very complex, this is much more complex than the plain conduction solution with no flow, but yet it is rather predictable, right? And that is what happens in the Taylor Couette geometry immediately after the first instability. But it is also possible that once the flow becomes unstable, you could also directly transition to turbulence. This is what happens in a pipe flow. There is no nice intermediate structure that forms which then gives way to turbulence. It is laminar and then immediately it becomes very complicated. So there are two different routes that are possible, and it really depends on which system you are looking at. Okay. So I will have a chance to comment on this in the later lectures, but I will just tell you briefly that in principle that it is not necessary that immediately after the instability you go to turbulence. You can go to more complex yet laminar states, time periodic states, and then which then become unstable to become more complex flows and then eventually leading to turbulence, or you could also directly transition to turbulence as in the case of a pipe. Okay. So yeah.
Sir, mathematically how is stability defined?
I'll come to this question. See, there are if you strictly speak mathematically, there are different versions of stability. If you look at from a dynamical systems point of view, there is something called asymptotic stability and stuff like that. So I'm not going to get into the definitions like that. I'll give a very practical yet mathematical definition of stability as we go along. I'll address this, of course, I'll address this question, but maybe in a few minutes, right? But if you look at literature or textbooks on dynamical systems, they'll give different meanings of instability. They'll say if you start from a point in a neighborhood epsilon and then if the solution remains bounded and stuff like that. So there are different mathematical definitions of that sort which I'll not get into, which is what textbooks like Arnold will do, but I'll do a what typically fluid mechanicians do, a very very practical yet a mathematical definition of this is not the one definition of instability, but that's not the only definition. I'll come to that in a few minutes, right? So how do you analyze and predict instabilities? Of course, as in any endeavor in science, you do experiments to observe the phenomenon, right? Computation plays a very important role these days because the Navier-Stokes equations are rather complicated. So computation, and of course you have to do theory, and I'll focus on the theoretical aspects of how to understand instabilities. Okay, so that is the goal of these lectures. I don't have time to do experiments. I encourage you to look at the video by Shapiro in YouTube. Okay. So the question that in simple terms, what we are looking at from a theoretical point of view is, if I have a flow, let's say in a pipe, and at some time t equal to zero, I introduce a disturbance. This is one way of understanding one way of looking at whether how to define stability. I introduce a disturbance and then I look at the response of the flow to this disturbance. Okay, so this is like a classical initial value problem where I have a system and then I disturb the system with a well defined initial condition. Okay, and then I look at the evolution of the system with respect to that initial condition, and if that disturbance is sufficiently small, okay, and then if the system becomes if the output of the response of the system is still taking the flow away from the laminar flow, then I would call it unstable. Okay, this is one working definition of hydrodynamic of instability, but I'll come to this shortly. Okay, so this cartoon is something that Professor Huppert also showed yesterday. So imagine having a particle in a potential well, and if you have a particle like this, if you move the particle around, if you perturb the particle, so to speak, the particle back to its and gravity being acting downwards, the particle comes back here, or if you have particle on a hill and then if you perturb it a little bit, it is going to run down. So this is a stable configuration and this is an unstable configuration. Here even if you put perturbations to the particle, it is going to come back to its equilibrium position, I mean assuming some friction somewhere, otherwise it will keep oscillating, right. So if there is some friction, it is going to come back and rest. Here of course the particle is going to run down. So this is the question that we are going to ask equivalent questions in fluid mechanics. You subject the flow to an initial disturbance and do these perturbations grow with time or decay with time, okay. And if they decay with time initially and then let us say they grow beyond a certain value of a parameter like Reynolds number, then we are interested in the question of at what value of Reynolds number does this happen, okay. Now when we do all this, we always have to keep in mind the question of infinitesimal versus finite disturbances. So this is the classic example. Suppose I have this, I bump on this, you know, sufficiently hard, it still seems to do. Now I do this, still doesn't happen, right. So but so this is a very tricky point, because even in the theory you know what is infinitesimal and what is finite is not not all that clear, okay. So this is a very sticky point, as I'll come to a bit later. But what essentially we are going to assume is that if in a flow there are some disturbances which can be avoided, like the disturbances due to horses moving in the daytime, which could be avoided in the nighttime, right, by Reynolds himself. But if you, there are some disturbances which are completely unavoidable, okay, no matter what you do, they are unavoidable. So those are assumed to be sufficiently small and those are called infinitesimal disturbances. Now this is a very, there is no hard and fast rule as to what is you know infinitesimal mathematically speaking, because I'll give you a what is infinitesimal shortly, but that's a circular argument. I'll come to that. But this is not a very obvious thing as to in order to decide what is small and what is finite. But what we are going to assume is that there must be some disturbances which are completely unavoidable, and those are the infinitesimal disturbances that we are going to subject the flow to. Of course you can also subject the flow to a very specific finite disturbance and look at the response experimentally. There is nothing that prevents you from doing that, but you know that is not something we do it in the beginning itself, because you always, you know, whenever you do theory, you always try to construct the theory towards an experimental observation. If you look at the experimental observation of Rayleigh-Bennard convection or Taylor coiled flow, you are not imposing any disturbance to the flow by yourself, by deliberate action. It just happens somewhere in the system, in the lab, and then it becomes unstable. Same with pi flow, you are not going, you are not doing anything special, because as undergraduate students, we always do this friction factor Reynolds experiments, and unlike most experiments, this gives, you don't have to fudge your data. It always gives the transition around 2000 to 2500, because those are the disturbances that, you know, no matter where you do the experiment, they are unavoidable. Of course, you can also subject the flows to more specific disturbances and study the response experimentally or even theoretically, but that's not what we are going to look at.
So is it, I mean, I've heard that people have gone to really very smooth pipes and increase this transition.
No, it's not smooth pipes. It doesn't have to do with the smoothness. It has to do with the controlled environment. So if you do it in a vibration-free environment, if you take care to, you know, isolate the disturbances, then you can push the Reynolds number. Reynolds himself pushed it to around 60,000 or something. He was able to push the Reynolds number at which laminar flow persists up to 60,000. But in the, you know, subsequent years, it has now gone to 10 to the 5.
Right.
So that is not, it has not got to do with the smoothness of the pipe. It is more to do with the the ambience of the laboratory, where you are taking extraordinary care to avoid any disturbances, and it is possible. Pi flow is a very bad example. I'll keep referring to that, but I'm talking about more traditional instabilities like Rayleigh-Bennard or Taylor coiled, where you do find that that's why pi flow is where everything, whatever I'm going to tell, fails, right. So I'm not going to that's such a bad example, although it is the experiment that started everything in this subject, okay. So when you look at sufficiently small disturbances, which we think are unavoidable in any experiment, then they are so small that when you subject the flow to such disturbances, it is possible to linearize the governing equations, as I will show you, about a given steady state. Therefore, the stability theory that addresses the stability of fluid flows to infinitesimal disturbances is called a linear stability theory, because of the fact that you are able to linearize the flow with disturbances about a given steady state, because the disturbances are sufficiently small. Okay. Right. So that's the next part of our discussion, the linear stability theory. Okay. So first, I'm going to sort of tell you a list of steps that one follows in getting in carrying out a linear stability analysis. So first, you have to specify the governing equations. For the purposes of this lecture and the consequent subsequent lectures, I'm going to assume the fluid to be Newtonian. Therefore, the governing equations are the Navier-Stokes equations, right? The continuity and the momentum equation. Now, of course, you need boundary conditions. At rigid surfaces, you have no slip conditions, right? Now, so the first thing to do is to find the base state of the flow, the laminar flow, whose stability you are interested in. So, for example, in the case of Hagen-Poisson flow in a pipe, that's the pipe Poisson velocity profile is the base state. Typically, I'm not saying always, but typically that base state is steady and unidirectional. It has only one velocity. It's not to say that all flows are unidirectional whose stability is you are trying to understand. Sometimes you have a two-dimensional flow as well. You can understand the stability of two-dimensional flows, but for the purposes of this lectures, I'm going to assume the flow to be unidirectional. Now, because the theme of the workshop as well as the symposium is complex fluids, now in complex fluids, you of course do not have the Navier-Stokes equations. You have something more complicated. The stress tensor is not given by the Newtonian constitutive relation, so you'll not have this. You'll have to have something else. So you need to specify the constitutive relation. So if you have a polymeric liquid, you have to put in the appropriate constitutive equation, and so on. And of course, I'm telling you about boundary conditions at the rigid surface. You also have boundary conditions or conditions at the interface between two fluids. For example, if you have fluid A flowing past fluid B, you have to worry about the conditions at the interface, which I'll come to a bit later. So you need to have the right set of governing equations and the boundary conditions, and you need to first find the base state, okay, of that system of equations that you have. Now, the next step, this mathematical step actually belongs to Reynolds. Reynolds thought of this in the context of understanding turbulent flows. So what Reynolds said was, you have a mean flow or the base flow, we call it the base flow or the laminar flow whose stability is of interest here, which I denote by a bar. It is independent of time, so it is a function only of spatial coordinates, and then you impose time dependent fluctuations. Okay, the fluctuations are time dependent, obviously. Okay, the parameter delta is a dimensionless parameter which measures how small the perturbations are. So because I'm assuming infinitesimal perturbations, I'm going to assume that delta is something that's very very small compared to one. Okay, that's what allows me to linearize. This is the mathematical definition of small disturbance, because I'm going to assume how small is delta. Delta is small enough such that linearization is valid. So that's what I mean by a circular argument, because I'm defining delta such that it allows me to linearize. So that's where the problem is actually. Okay. So imagine you have a laminar flow like this, and then I put some arbitrary perturbation like this. Then I get a flow superimposed with fluctuations. So that is this combined velocity field. Okay. So what are the key questions once you do this? Now, for a given control parameter like Reynolds, does the perturbation grow or decay with time? This is like what I told you a few minutes back. This is the classical initial value problem. So you look at a perturbation, and then you are worrying about, for a given initial condition, whether these fluctuations will grow. If they grow with time, that means that the laminar flow will not be observed in reality. If they decay with time, then the laminar flow returns is a stable solution. Now, what is the critical value of that parameter like Reynolds or Taylor number or Rayleigh number for that to happen, for the growth to happen? That is what is going to be observed in experiments. Okay. And in addition, you can also find the spatial structure at the onset of instability. For example, in the Rayleigh-Bernard case, you have this convection rolls. In Taylor-Couette case, again, you had this Taylor rolls. All this, the spatial structure can be predicted from such a theory. Okay. Okay. So the key thing in linearization, in Navier-Stokes, as I told you, all terms in the Navier-Stokes are linear except the convective nonlinearity, which is V dot grad V. Now, so you have to linearize only that term because all the other terms are by definition linear. You cannot linearize them. So if you take V dot grad V and then substitute the Reynolds decomposition, right, V bar plus V prime del V prime, then you get terms like this, right. There is a term which is V bar dot grad V bar, which is purely laminar, which is the base state contribution. There is a term that is proportional to delta V bar dot grad V prime plus V prime dot grad V bar. And there is a term that is proportional to delta squared. It is, yeah. But it is not as clean as this. In laminar flow, you know that the base state is a you know, a turbulent flow is already a fluctuating flow, only the mean is independent of time. But it is that is what I said, you can do, but it is not clear whether it is as clean as for laminar flows, because here there are only fluctuations are due to the disturbances, whereas there are, you know, already there are fluctuations in a turbulent flow. Oh yeah, yeah. For secondary instabilities, you can do this. Okay, so the question he is asking is: suppose you have, you know, the Rayleigh-Bernard convection. You have an initial conduction state where there is no flow. Then beyond a critical Rayleigh number, you have this convection rolls. So if I still increase the temperature difference or Rayleigh number effectively, you can worry about the stability of these rolls. Those can be understood using the same idea. Yes. But because the flow structure still is rather clean and neat, it's can be, you know, at best it's time periodic, right? But if you have a turbulent flow, I mean, although people do it, I'm not very sure whether it is as, you know, clean as this analysis. No, as rigorous as this analysis, because you already have fluctuations and it's not clear what fluctuations you're imposing, so there are questions. Right, so when I take the nonlinear, when I substitute the Reynolds decomposition in the Navier-Stokes, I find that I have a purely a term which is purely comprised of base state quantities, a term that is linear in the perturbations, and a term that's nonlinear. Because the nonlinearity in Navier-Stokes is a quadratic nonlinearity, you will get terms only of the order delta squared, right? And by definition, in a linear stability analysis, what you do is you neglect terms of order delta squared compared to terms of order delta. Okay, so you throw away this term, and this is the trivial laminar flow contribution. Many a times this is identically 0. For example, if you have pipe Poisson flow, this is identically 0 because V is perpendicular to grad V, so they are orthogonal to each other, so that is 0. But even if it is there, it will cancel out in the linear stability analysis, because that is going to balance something else in the Navier-Stokes in the base state. Okay, so you include terms only that are order delta in the analysis. So that is why you call it a linear stability analysis, right? And the terms that are higher order delta squared, right, those are neglected, because you are assuming the perturbations to be infinitesimal, sufficiently small, right? That's why the subject is called linear stability analysis. And by definition, therefore, you can predict only the onset of instability, because suppose you argue that the flow is unstable, then the disturbances grow with time, then the magnitude of the disturbances will no longer be small enough for you to justify linearization. That means that the mathematical framework that we are developing is good enough to predict only the point at which the flow will become unstable, because once the flow becomes unstable, you will find that typically the disturbances grow rather rapidly, and then no longer, I mean, they will no longer be small enough for you to justify the neglect of the nonlinear terms, then you have to take into account the nonlinear terms in a special way. That's called a weakly nonlinear stability. So I'll not have time to discuss that in detail, but it is possible, but that's much more difficult compared to the linear stability analysis. Okay. Now so when you collect terms of order delta in a linear stability analysis, you get a set of linearized partial differential equations. This is the linearized, I mean the continuity equation is already linear, so you will have only a linear equation here. So if you have the momentum, if you see the momentum equation, this is purely a perturbation quantity, but the nonlinear term will have couplings between the base flow and fluctuations. This is v bar dot del v prime, this is v prime dot del v bar. So these are the terms that are equivalent to Reynolds stresses in a turbulent flow, but those are purely nonlinear. This is in some sense a linearized version of Reynolds stress that siphons off energy from mean flow to fluctuations. So if you have flow in a channel to become unstable, definitely the energy transfer must appear via these terms. The other terms are purely linear in the fluctuations. Okay, and of course you have boundary conditions that the velocity disturbance must also satisfy the no slip conditions at the rigid boundaries. Okay, okay. So before I sort of tell you about how to think about this problem, how to solve this problem, I thought I'll illustrate this in the board using a much simpler matrix, simple ODE kind of a setting, just to motivate what we are going to do. Okay. So the broad idea for me is to tell you the difference between how to think about an initial value problem, which is what we are now faced with, because you have a set of linearized partial differential equations subject to suitable boundary conditions and presumably an initial condition. Okay. Now the point is, in reality, if you do experiments, you don't have any control over the initial conditions. You don't know what the initial conditions are, right? Unless you do a very specific hydrodynamic stability experiment, let's say where you have a pipe and then at some specified time you impose a specified type of disturbance into the flow, and then you look at its response, that's a controlled initial condition. But the kind of things that we do normally in laboratory is that there the initial conditions are not known. Okay. So here we are faced with a very peculiar situation, in the sense that in normal fluid mechanics or heat transfer, you typically know you have a set of partial differential equations, be they linear or nonlinear, but you have a set of well defined initial condition and boundary conditions, and then you say for given set of initial and boundary conditions, what are the solutions, right? But in hydrodynamic stability, you are faced with a puzzle, in the sense that you want to understand the stability of the system, but you do not know what the initial conditions are. Okay, because that's the reality. So you want to be able to make predictions without having complete information about the system. Okay, this is very unusual, as opposed to the usual problems that we do in heat transfer or fluid mechanics, right? So how do we get around this problem? Okay, in order to get around this problem, you have to understand a little bit of linear vector spaces. And in order to showcase that aspect, it's very easy to show this in the context of a simple ODE. So I'm going to do that, simple 2x2 kind of two set of variables, coupled variables in ordinary differential equation framework, and then I'll tell you the connection as to how you can comment on the stability of the system using what is called the eigenvalue approach. So we are not in hydrodynamic stability theory. You're not going to look at the Usually speaking, you are not going to look at the initial value problem. Instead, you look at the eigenvalue problem. So what is the connection and what are you losing out by completely ignoring the initial conditions? These are comments that are very, very crucial in order to understand the mathematical framework behind what we are going to do. So I am going to do this in the context of a simple ODE, system of ODE. So let's say you have a vector x. So A is a matrix, so X is let's say just a vector with two elements, right? Let's consider a system of two coupled ODEs. You can have many variables as well, but just to make my point, it's sufficient to consider two coupled ODEs. Okay? So I'm going to assume A is a 2x2 matrix, right? So if I want to solve this, and A is independent of X, so it's a linear system of coupled ODEs. Okay, right. So if I want to solve this, so if you want, I can write it like this: dx1 dt. There are two variables, dx2 dt, is, let us say, A11, A12, A21 operating on X1, X2, where A11, these are constant elements, they are independent of time and they are independent of X1, X2 as well, they are just numbers. Okay. Now, many of you would have solved this in your first courses in mathematics, right. The way to, and it is not just for this linear system, you can have an n by n matrix as well with n variables. The way to do is this is to diagonalize the matrix, right, and then go to the space where all the equations get decoupled, right. So, in some sense, what you are doing is to, instead of writing the vector x in an arbitrary basis, you are trying to write the, represent the vector x in the eigenbasis of the matrix A. When you do that, the equations get completely decoupled. Okay. So, when you decouple like that, then it is some trivial matter to solve the equations, because now you have n independent equations. Now, if you have n independent first order differential equations, you know that the time dependence is exponential in time. If you simply have only one equation, you know that if you have dx1 by dt is lambda 1 x1, you know that x1 of t is x1 of 0 times e to the lambda 1 t. If I have n such decoupled equations, right, then you know that all the n variables in that basis are going to evolve purely exponentially in time. Okay. So, that is the point of going from an arbitrary basis to an eigenbasis, to the basis where I represent the vector x in terms of the eigenvectors of the matrix A. Okay. The reason why I am explaining this, taking some time in this, is what we are going to do there is not very different from here, although it is little more involved in terms of more, because you are talking about a PDE and you are talking about functions, you are not talking about simple, you know, ODEs, right. But in principle, everything remains the same in terms of the steps that we are going to carry out here and the steps I am going to use to motivate this expansion. Okay. Right. So, what, in order to do this, what I am going to do is to first consider. So, first let us postulate that the solution is going to look like this, because it is a first order system and it is A is a constant coefficient matrix. So, I expect the solution should also should be exponential in time. So, I write x of t as some e to the lambda t times v. Okay. Now, then I say what is dx by dt, it is lambda e to the lambda t times v. Okay. If I plug this in here, then I will get an eigenvalue problem for v. If I substitute this on this side, the e to the lambda t is cancelled. Okay. So, all I will get is a v is lambda v, which is an so v is basically the eigenvectors of the matrix, eigenvector of the matrix A. Okay. Right. So, now once you solve for the eigenvalues of the matrix A, let us say lambda 1, lambda 2, these are the eigenvalues. And let us say the corresponding eigenvectors are v1 and v2. Okay. Because that is a standard eigenvalue problem, a matrix eigenvalue problem, right. Then, okay, suppose I want to solve the problem dx dt is equal to ax, our original problem, subject to the initial condition that x of t equal to 0 is x0. Okay, that is the initial specific initial condition that I have, right. Now, in order to solve that problem, the first thing I do is to expand this initial condition vector in terms of the eigenvectors of the matrix A. Okay. So, I will write okay. Now, then the general solution for this equation, this linear equation, is x of t is c1 e to the lambda 1 t v1 plus c2 okay. Now, this satisfies the initial condition. because if you put time t equal to 0, then it identically gives x naught. That's your initial value of the vector x, right? And it also satisfies the differential equation by just substituting and realizing the fact that AV is lambda V. You will find that this is in fact a solution to this system of linear equations. Okay. So, what I am trying to convince you is that in order to a linear system like this, a system of ODEs like this, if you take the traditional route of solving it to a specific initial condition, you will get of course a solution, a time dependent solution, which can be expressed in terms of the eigenvalues and eigenvectors of the matrix. The linear operator here is the matrix A, right. Now, suppose I ask the question, I do not have an initial condition, can we say something, I do not have a specific initial condition, can we say something about the solution? Okay. The answer is yes, because even without looking at C1 and C2, okay, assuming lambda 1, lambda 2 to be real, not complex for now, right, just for simplicity. Suppose I ask you the question, I do not tell you what is x naught, that means I do not tell you what the coefficients C1 and C2 are, then can it say something about the behavior of the solution at sufficiently long times? Then you will immediately tell me that yes, you can, if you just look at the eigenvalues lambda 1 and lambda 2, because if lambda 1 and lambda, if one of the eigenvalues have positive real values, then you will have an exponentially growing solution regardless of what the initial condition is, right. So, by looking at the eigenvalue of the underlying differential matrix operator, which is a linear operator, right, it is possible to comment on whether the solutions are going to blow up in time or whether they are going to decay in time without having a specific knowledge of the initial condition. So, in a very very simplistic way, this toy problem in linear ODEs is telling us something deep, that in order to comment on the asymptotic behavior as time t goes to infinity of whether something is going to grow exponentially in time or decay exponentially in time, it is not necessary to look at specific initial conditions, although that can be done if you have the luxury of knowing the initial condition, obviously you should do it, but in the absence of a knowledge of the initial condition, then how are you going to look at whether things are going to blow exponentially time or decay exponentially time? The only way to do is to look at the eigenvalues of the underlying operator, of the underlying linear operator, because any solution to the linear system can be expressed in terms of the eigenbasis of the underlying linear operator, and the corresponding time dependence will be given by the corresponding eigenvalues. Okay, because it is a first order system in time, the time dependence is exponential, first order and linear system in time, it is exponential, therefore you can always look at the eigenvalues. Now, there are few special cases that one can discuss. Suppose you say that lambda 1 is positive and lambda 2 is negative. Just for the sake of argument, right? If in a given problem, if lambda 1 is positive and lambda 2 is negative, both are real, and let us say your initial condition is such that C1 is 0, okay. For that special initial condition, obviously you will have a decaying solution, okay. But for an arbitrary initial condition, okay, it will be, you know, you will have both C1 and C2 non-zero in general, okay. Then you will always have some component of the growing solution in your final solution, okay. If you have a very very special initial condition, if you say lambda 1 is greater than 0 and that special initial condition has only C2 and C1 is identically 0, then obviously your system is going to decay eventually with time, because you have an e to the negative exponential in time, right. But that is a very special initial condition. But what you are interested in hydrodynamic stability is that you are trying to represent an arbitrary initial condition in terms of a suitable eigenbasis, okay. In that context, even if one of the eigenvalues has in this simple system, even if one of the eigenvalues has a positive real part and the other has a negative real part, an arbitrary initial condition will have both the constants to be non-zero, and therefore the final solution will always have that growing part, because you are not looking at special initial conditions, you are looking at an arbitrary initial condition where all the eigenbases, all the eigenvectors will be represented in the expansion, okay. This is the key idea behind hydrodynamic stability, where you do not look, you do not intend or even hope to solve for an initial value problem usually, but you try it because of the nature of the subject itself, because you do not have a precise idea of what the initial conditions are. In such a scenario, you are now left with understanding only the stability of the system to with you know incomplete information. So, therefore, you look at eigenvalue problem, and when you look at the eigenvalue problem, then if you have some eigenvalues, let us assume the eigenvalues to be real, if even one eigenvalue has a positive real part, then there is an arbitrary initial condition when expanded on the eigenbasis will have that component in the solution, and at sufficiently long times, that is large times, that is going to grow exponentially in time. So, just by looking at eigenvalues, you can comment on what is called asymptotic stability. Now, this is my first definition of, so we are usually we are interested in looking at what is called asymptotic stability. That is, as time t tending to infinity, can we say something about whether the system is going to grow exponentially in time or decay exponentially in time. Now, by definition, this has its drawbacks, okay, I'll come to that shortly, but this is what traditionally in we do in hydrodynamic stability, and there is a name for this, this is called the method of normal modes, okay. This comes from mechanics, where if you have a coupled system of springs and masses, classical oscillator, harmonic oscillator, if you want to decouple the system, okay, you go to the eigenbasis, because it is complete, if you have a bunch of n masses and springs, and then if you write down the Newton's equation, you will get a system of coupled equations. If you want to decouple the system, you go to the eigenbasis, and then the modes of oscillation are called the normal modes. So, what we are doing is sort of similar in philosophical sense, that you are also representing your solution in terms of the eigenbasis. So, loosely this method is typically called the method of normal modes. You know, if you are not comfortable with that terminology, you can just call it asymptotic stability, because we are not, or eigenvalue based stability, because we are not looking at a specific initial condition. Instead, we are hoping to address general arbitrary initial condition whose specific form we do not know, and we are taking that to our advantage. The imprecise knowledge of the initial, in fact, you do not have any knowledge of the initial condition, that is taken to our advantage, and we say that we are going to look at only what is going to happen as time t goes to infinity, and there you do look at eigenvalues and you can comment on whether things are going to grow or decay. Now, this by its very nature, it has its own limitations. Now, I will just hint at what the limitation is right now, because we are right in the topic. Suppose I say lambda 1, lambda 2 both are negative, okay. Now, as per this theory, then all disturbances must decay in time as time t goes to infinity, because both eigenvalues are negative. If you any arbitrary initial condition, therefore, should decay in time in this simplest possible problem, right. But in reality, what will happen is, it is possible that if the matrix is not Hermitian or self adjoint, then it is possible that the eigenvectors v1, v2 are not orthogonal to begin with, right. So, it is possible to have special initial conditions which grow transiently and then decay eventually. So, this is some amplitude of the disturbance as a function of time. The theory predicts that it is going to be stable if both lambda 1 lambda 2 are negative, and that is in fact true, okay, because eventually you will find decay. But at early times, if the matrix has special properties, it is possible for the matrix the eigenvectors to mix in such a manner that at least at initial times you will have a non-exponential growth, because exponentially they are decaying, but you can have an algebraic growth. This is sometimes called transient growth, okay, in hydrodynamic stability. It is transient because eventually it is going to decay, right, because the eigenvalues are negative. So, exponentially it is going to decay as time t goes to infinity, but at early times it is possible, if your matrices are such, then you do have an early time growth, and this is important in many, many cases as well. So, by looking at only eigenvalues, you are losing out on the possibility of what is called transient growth. Now, this has been shown to be very important in the last 15 years, especially for flows in channels and pipes, okay. So, the transient growth phenomenon, because understand that if the transient growth itself is sufficiently strong, even though it is not exponential, right, it can take the magnitude of the, it can make the magnitude of the disturbances sufficiently strong enough for non-linearities to become important. So the linear stability ansatz is no longer valid, right, because you are assuming everything based on the fact that the disturbances are infinitesimal. But even if you have exponential decay at large times, if there is an early time growth, okay, right, then that can take the system to a nonlinear regime, whereby nonlinearity can take over. So these are things that are missed out when you just focus on eigenvalues. So this is a at the same, I'm also pointing out the limitations of this normal mode analysis, which are very important in a certain class of flows. But for a majority of flows, the normal mode analysis or the eigenvalue based analysis has turned out to be a remarkably successful approach. So I'll stick to that in the beginning, but with a caveat that, you know, you must be aware of these limitations. By focusing only on the eigenvalues, you are missing out on phenomenon like transient growth, right, which can be important in certain cases. Oh, I see. So okay. So this is in the context of the simplest case of a simple ordinary system of two ordinary differential equations, where we did conclude that by looking at the eigenvalues, you can comment on the long time nature of the solution without worrying about initial conditions, understanding the limitations of such an approach. Okay. So. But in some sense, all I am saying is we are doing away with, suppose you take the initial value approach. Suppose you say that I don't want to look at eigenvalues. Suppose you didn't, you are not aware of this approach. What will you do? You will have a system of linearized PDEs subject to some boundary conditions and a initial condition. You will have to test the stability to how many initial conditions, right? Because you do not know the nature of the initial condition. Right, how many initial conditions can we test, right? So that is a difficult, you know, kind of thing to do, because so what instead we do is, because you do not know initial conditions and because eigenvalues do determine the nature of stability at large times, we are saying that let's just look at eigenvalues, and by looking at eigenvalues we can indeed comment on the long time stability or asymptotic stability. But at the same time, I'm trying to also point out the drawbacks of such an approach, because if you do find the flow to be stable, it is still not guaranteed that you know, because you are foreclosing the option of a transient growth in some cases, not in all cases, in some cases. Okay, that's the point I'm trying to make. So you cannot test the, you know, if you want to solve the initial value problem, unless you are sure of a given experiment where the nature of the initial condition is specifically clear and it's precise, then there is for a arbitrary experiment like the Rayleigh-Bernard convection experiment, where you do not impose any initial condition, then you are yet, you still want to make predictions, right? So the approach that the normal mode approach is remarkably successful in many cases, but it also fails in some cases. So that's a point I want to hint at right away in the beginning. That's what I'm assuming here, but in the case where there is transient growth, then the eigenvectors are not orthogonal. That leads to some mixing, even though they are stable sufficiently at large times, right? There can be some positive reinforcement leading to a transient growth. So it depends on the nature of this matrix. I mean, loosely speaking, or the operator, the underlying structure of the operator is very important. Adjoint. So that's what I'm assuming. If the matrix is self-adjoint, then the eigenvectors are orthogonal, right? Then I can make all the statements. Whatever I'm making, the asymptotic stability will always be like this. The decay will always be like this. Okay. But if the matrix is not self-adjoint, then there is this possibility. Although it is going to, I mean, it's not starting at zero, starting at some initial value. But it's going to grow enormously. It can grow enormously and then come back to, you know, at zero at sufficiently large times. So that is in the classical normal mode analysis, you are not going to worry about that possibility, because all you are going to do is look at individual eigenvalues of the operator. And then even if one eigenvalue has positive real part, imagine extending this to an n by n system. There are n eigenvalues, right? I mean, the same thing goes through. There are n eigenvalues. Even if there are one eigen, even if there is a one eigenvalue with positive real part, the system will become unstable for an arbitrary disturbance, because any disturbance potentially will have all the eigenvectors in its expansion. Here, I said that x naught is this and this, right? In principle, I can imagine extending this for n different coefficients. Okay, even if one eigenvalue is positive, right, in the solution has positive real part, that is going to take over at sufficiently large times, and things are going to grow exponentially, right? So regardless of what the initial condition is, even if one eigenvalue has positive real part, then the system is going to become unstable. There is no ambiguity in that. The question comes, what happens when you have all the eigenvalues to be negative? Is there a possibility of that when all the eigenvalues are negative for that n by n system, then potentially as time t tends to infinity, that system, the initial condition is going to decay to 0. There is no doubt in that. What happens at early times? Okay, that is something that is not answered by the classical normal mode analysis, especially when the matrix is not a self-adjoint matrix.
But transient mode, will it matter because we are considering asymptotic behavior at t equal to infinity?
No, we are considering, but then that's because we want to consider only the asymptotic growth. But in reality, if this is there, then it can take the system to a regime where finite the disturbances become finite, and therefore you could have nonlinear effects start becoming important. Because right now we are assuming everything to be small enough that linearization is valid. Within the linearization, the transient growth is also a linearized phenomenon. It's not a nonlinear phenomenon, because even within a linear stability, you can have eigenvectors to mix in such a manner that you get a short time growth. But if that short time growth takes the system, the magnitude of the disturbances to be sufficiently large enough, then nonlinearities can become important. Okay. So while this, looking at individual eigenvalues, is called the normal mode theory, this transient growth by definition is called non-modal growth. Because the growth, the individual, if the individual modes are supposed to decay, yet you are finding growth at early times, not at large times, that's called non-modal growth, because it is not the growth of a single mode. It is that growth is caused by superposition of modes. Okay, that's why it's called it's sometimes called transient growth. It's sometimes called algebraic growth. Sometimes called non-modal growth. Yeah. Well, the same Navier-Stokes equations are valid for Rayleigh-Bernard as well, right? Well, Taylor quiet flow, there is mean flow, right? So it is not, I mean, not necessarily, it's not the nature of Navier-Stokes equation. It's the base state about which you linearize the Navier-Stokes equation. So for example, Taylor quiet flow, the normal mode analysis works remarkably successfully, and the operator is self-adjoint there, and there is no transient growth. It's still the same Navier-Stokes equation as in the pi flow or plane Poisson flow. So it's not that you cannot blame the equation. You should blame the base flow about which you linearize, right? Because it's the same equation anyway in Taylor quiet as well. Any other questions up to this point? Okay, so now I'm going to, explain a little bit about what is shown in this expansion, and then So imagine you have a linearized set of Navier-Stokes equations, and as I just mentioned, you have to specify a base flow. Right, first, and you are linearizing about that base flow. So let's, just for the sake of concreteness, let's assume a channel flow between two rectangular plates, and then it's a rectangular channel, and you have this parabolic velocity profile called the plane Poisson flow. That is our laminar flow or base flow. Okay, and the flow is in the x direction. The gradient is in the y direction and z direction goes outside the board, that is the direction of vorticity. Okay. Now, what you do is the following. Now, here in the simple ODE problem, I took the operator, A is the operator, linear operator I had, and then it is easy to find the eigenvectors and eigenvalues of this matrix, it is a linear operator, and then I expanded the solution in terms of the eigenvectors and eigenvalues. I am going to do the same in the case of this linearized PDE, but PDEs are a bit more complicated, so you have to understand this a bit slowly. Now, I am going to explain this step by step. So, look at the x direction, it is an infinite direction, it is translationally invariant. So, the correct eigenbasis in that direction is actually a Fourier transform. Okay. If I have a finite region, then I can think of a Fourier series. If I have a periodic domain, I can think of a Fourier series, but it is a truly infinite domain. So, I have to do a Fourier transform in the x direction. Okay. And then along the z direction also, which is coming outside the board, it is translationally invariant and infinite, and there also I will do a Fourier transform in that direction. Now, in the third confined direction, the y direction, okay, it is not an infinite direction, so I do not know what the eigenfunctions are. For Fourier series or Fourier transform, we know what the eigenfunctions are, these are e to the I k x, e to the I l x or whatever, right. For the confined directions, I do not know what the eigenfunctions are, but I know that confinement usually brings in a discreteness in the eigenvalue. Okay, that is, the moment you put confinement, the eigenvalues get discrete, whereas if you take a Fourier transform, any real number is an eigenvalue, right. So, what I am going to do is express any disturbance, okay, as a Fourier series in the x direction. So, there is a Fourier integral with wave number kx, a Fourier series in the a Fourier transform in the x direction, that is a Fourier integral with wave number kx. This is another Fourier integral in wave number kz, right. And now along the confined direction, I do not know what the eigenfunctions are. So, I am going to simply write them as fn of y, because I have to solve for them. Okay. Now, in addition, so if I do a Fourier transform, then I have e to the ikx. So, there are two different wave numbers, kxx and kzz, because x is this direction and z is that direction, right. So, I have a double integral and a summation. Okay. Now, the time dependence, I am just keeping it as, so this is a n, this is the coefficients of expansion in the discrete variable, and because it is continuous in the other two directions, it becomes a function, this k represents both kx and kz, and time is left as such, but in any linear problem, the time dependence is always exponential, as I just showed you here also, that if you have dx dt is lambda x, it is a linear first order system, then the time dependence is exponential. So, eventually you can think of doing a Laplace transform in t, and then you will get you will pick up a e to the st. Okay. If you were to think of solving an initial value problem, you solve initial value problems using Laplace transform, right. So, you do a double Fourier transform in the x and z directions, a finite eigenbasis expansion in the finite y direction, and also you do a Laplace transform in time. Okay. So, that is the idea of this eigenfunction expansion. Okay. Now, I want to impress on you the fact that this expansion is fundamentally no different from this expansion. I mean, but for the fact that, I mean, I have used an exponential, suppose I do not want to use exponentials, I want to use a 1 of t. Suppose I was were to write like this, and then later on denote a 1 t to be some c 1 e to the lambda 1 t, a 2 t, yeah. So, this will be, this is no different from this expansion, philosophically speaking. You are merely expanding the function, here it is a function only of time in terms of the eigenbasis, right. Here you are expanding a function which is a function of spatial coordinates, three spatial coordinates and time, right. So, this a n of t is similar to this a 1 of t. So, here there are only two eigenfunctions. Here there are many number of discrete eigenfunctions in the y direction, but along the x and z directions it is a, you know, continuous set of eigenvalues. So, you have to do an integral. So, if you were to think of these integrals as summations again, you have a triple summation because you have three different coordinate directions, but fundamentally it is the same as this. Okay. Now, what did we do in terms of understanding? Suppose I write A in terms of the exponentials, e to the lambda 1 t and e to the lambda 2 t. So, what did I tell you? We do not have to worry about expanding at all. We just look at the eigenvectors, the individual eigenvectors. In the same way, this summation is just notional. We are not going to do the summation or anything in our normal mode analysis, because the moment you realize that you are interested only in asymptotic behavior, then you are not going to do any of this. You are going to look at a representative term like this, which is what we did here also. We just looked at what is e to the lambda 1 t, whether that is going to grow in time or a representative eigenvalue. In the same way, we are going to look at a representative term of this equation, of this expansion rather, and then we are going to look at its behavior, right. So, when I substitute one of the terms in this summation, that is a representative term, into the differential equation, you can imagine what will happen. Because the time dependence in the x and z directions are known, then the differential equations will no longer be PDEs, they will get converted to ODEs, ok. The only dependent variable will be in the y direction, the confined direction, and if I write a n of t in terms of exponential of eigenvalues, the time derivative will become, will comprise of the eigenvalue, right. So, you will get, therefore, by substituting a term of this equation back in here, assuming a to be vx, vy, vz and so on. So, you will have different eigenfunctions in the, you know, you will have vx tilde of y and t, and I mean, you will have instead of f, you will have vx tilde, vy tilde and so on, different eigenfunctions for different velocities. So, if you substitute all that, then what you will get is a simple linearized ordinary differential equation, but with an eigenvalue. So, that is very similar to reaching here. See, I motivated the solution of this equation as if I wanted to solve an initial value problem. Now, but then now I am turning it around and saying, since I do not know the initial conditions, I am not going to solve the initial value problem. I am just going to substitute this, a representative term, back in the equation, much like I did here. Then what did I get? If I substituted this here, I will get this, right. And once I solve for the eigenvalue or eigenvalues, then I can comment on the asymptotic stability in a very, very similar manner. If I substitute one representative term back in the linearized Navier-Stokes equation, which is a PDE with a time dependent derivative, because I am going to assume exponential dependence on time, the time derivative will also vanish. You will simply get an ODE, right. Of course, a much complicated ODE, but still it is a linear ODE, but with an eigenvalue subjected to boundary conditions, right. So, that is what you typically solve in a normal mode analysis. So, this is possible because if you look at linear systems, you can study the dynamics of all modes individually, because only in linear systems you can expand an unknown in terms of the eigenfunctions very completely, right. So, you do this individually, and the time dependence is always exponential, right, because it is a first order system in time, and the term that occurs, the coefficient that occurs in the exponent, exponential in time, is called the growth rate, sometimes called the complex growth rate, because it could have a real part which tells you about growth, and the imaginary part tells you about frequency of oscillation. And if the real part of that eigenvalue is greater than 0, it is unstable. If it is less than 0, it is stable, and if it is 0, it is neutrally stable, it is neither stable nor unstable, ok. So, that is the outcome of the analysis. So, once you do that, once you substitute and do that, that is out. So, if all the eigenvalues, if even one Fourier mode, I mean each representative term in this, sorry, each representative term in this summation is called a Fourier mode or a normal mode. If all the modes decay, if eigenvalues corresponding to all these modes decay, then the system is stable, right, as time t going to infinity. I am looking at only asymptotic stability, right. But if even one mode grows in time, then the system is unstable at time t goes to infinity. So, the problem now boils down to the solution of coupled ordinary differential equations for variables like vx of y, vy of y and so on, with an eigenvalue, and you have a control parameter like Reynolds, So you have to compute the eigenvalues for different values of the Reynolds number, and then you see whether all the eigenvalues are negative with negative real parts, or there are some eigenvalues with positive real parts. So that basically you have boiled down the stability calculation to an eigenvalue problem. Okay. So what I will do is, this is a, I mean actually I am hitting my end time, it is 5:30 already. So this is the right place to stop as well, because I plan to do a very trivial toy example before going into real hydrodynamic instability problems. Okay. So I will stop here and I will be happy to answer questions.